Shabbat Shalom. Good to see you all here. Let's turn to page one, if you can. If you can't, look at the screen.
I guess.
The song is Ma Tovu.
How many of you like like sleeping when the rain is falling on your roof. But you got up anyway, and you came to service.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Welcome to Adat Shabbat, the hope of Zion congregation. So good to see you all here on this liquid sunshine day. Are you excited for the rain? You should be. You should be. We need it. We always need rain. God's going to give us spiritual rain in our hearts too, right?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. How many of you came in through the other door today? Did you notice the difference? How many of you tried to get into that door? Some of you did. Yeah, three of you. Look at that. Two. I need to see two people. I said three would try. So we still have one more. When I drove up, Pastor made me park there. And then he put a sign in my car, for sale. Isn't that what it says?
I thought it was a fundraiser.
It could be, yeah. Just don't take a sledgehammer to it. And he said I might be able to drive it home tonight. I won't have to leave it there tomorrow. But anyway, the lock is broke, and it'll be fixed Monday. And, you know, you got to have a lock, you know. But the alarm was still set, but we got to use the other door. Wow. Ooh, we've been here like 2 years since that door was put in, and we still haven't never got to use it. So you should feel honored that we were the first to ever use that door. Wow. Maybe.
Hallelujah.
Maybe not. Anyway, let's just read Psalm 15 instead, huh? We're going to worship the Lord, not the door.
Yes, thank you. He is the door.
And Psalm 15 is a psalm by David. Hashem, who may sojourn in your tent? Who may dwell on your holy mountain? One who walks in perfect innocence and does what is right and speaks the truth from his heart, who has no slander on his tongue, who has done his fellow no evil nor cast disgrace upon his close one, in whose eyes a contemptible person is repulsive, but who honors those who fear Hashem, who can swear to his detriment without retracting, who lends not his money on interest and takes not a bribe against the innocent. The doer of these shall not falter forever. Amen.
Amen.
All right, so why don't we just go to page 2, huh? And praise the Lord. And if you stand up, you get closer to him.
Baruch et Adonai Hamburach. Baruch Adonai Hamburach Leolam Vayed.
Bless the Lord who is worthy to be praised. Blessed be the Lord who is worthy to be praised forever and ever.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kivod, Malchuto Leolam Vayed.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be his name, whose glorious kingdom is forever and ever.
V'havta et Adonai Elohecha, v'kol levavcha, uv'kol nafshecha, uv'kol me'odecha. V'hayu ha'dvarim ha'eleh, asher anochi, mitzvucha hayom olavecha. V'shidatam levinecha, v'dibatabam v'shivtecha v'veitecha, uv'lektecha v'aderech. Ushak paka ukumecha, ukshartam la ot ayadecha, bahayu la tota fot beit enecha, uktaptam al mezuzo betecha, uvish arecha.
And you should love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. Let these matters that I command you today be upon your heart. Teach them diligently to your children, and speak of them while you sit in your home, while you walk on the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. Bind them as a sign upon your arm, and let them be a sign between your eyes, and write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. And you should love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments rest the entire Torah and the prophets. And we'll go to page 6.
Die. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu et derech ha-Yeshua v'Mashiach Yeshua.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the way of salvation in Messiah Yeshua. Amen. Please turn to page 7 for the Amidah. Page 7.
Eloheinu. Kadshenu b'mitzvotecha, b'tein chelkenu b'toratecha, saveyu mituvecha, b'sachenu b'yeshuatecha, b'tayer libeinu le'avdecha.
Our God and God of our fathers, be pleased with our rest. Sanctify us through thy commandments and set our portion in thy Torah. Gratify us with thy goodness, gladden us through thy salvation, and purify our hearts to serve thee in truth. Give us thy holy Sabbath, Lord our God, with love and favor as our heritage. And may Israel, who sanctifies thy name, rest on it. Blessed art thou, Lord, who sanctifies the Sabbath. Amen.
Amen.
Yeshua gave us this prayer. Avinu Shabbat Shemayim, Yikadesh Shemcha, Tavo Malchuticha, Ya'aser Ratzoncha Ba'aretz, Ka'asher Na'asa Ba'Shemayim. Ten Lanu Hayom Lechem Chukenu, Uslach Lanu Et Ashmatenu, Ka'asher Solchim Anachnu, La'asher Ashmulanu, Va'al Tivienu Lede Masa, Ki'im Hatzilenu Min Hara, Ki'lecha Hamam Lecha, Vahagvura, Vahatiferet, Leolame, Olamim, Amen.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy Thy kingdom come.
How about some praise and worship then?
I'm live. There is no time.
Amen.
Oh, I should change the music. I guess I forget the words.
Alba, Nakila, Alba, Nakila, Alba. Nakila te disvata, Nakila hava, Nakila hava, Nakila be nisvata, hava de ranena, hava de ranena, hava de ranena, be. Abba, Niranina, Abba, Niranina, Abba, Niranina, Benismata. Hey!
so thankful for the Ruach HaKodesh. Hallelujah. And that Yeshua is my Savior and my Lord. And that Abba is my Papa. Hallelujah. Abba, that's a good word, isn't it? You know, if you're an Israeli and you're the child in the family, you know what you call your daddy? Abba. And they were good too.
Give us rain, O Lord, send your rain. Let your Spirit wash our hearts with power, your power. Make us new, make us vessels, Lord, for you. Let the name of God be our strong tower. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Our words a joyous song. Let the chains fall from our hearts in praise, in your praise. Through your Son, the victory has been won. Make us, Lord, to walk in your ways. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Lift him up, oh, lift Yeshua up, let the eyes of Israel, behold your Son, Messiah, King, the Lord of everything. Let Jacob hold the Holy One. Hallelujah, oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Service, and we have the Torah in here, and Paul lifts the Torah up, and the Hebrew is facing you, and you can see the Word of God, and Yeshua said, if I be lifted up, I draw all men unto me. Hallelujah. Every time I see that Torah lifted up like that, and of course, Paul usually puts it down before I want him to. Well, you know what? It's heavy. How many of you know doing this, you know, being out? How many of you have walked up to somebody and just told them about the Messiah? How many of you have experienced how heavy the Torah can be? You know, I don't blame Paul for putting it down, because quite frankly, if it was me holding it up, it would be up and then down right away. But, yeah, you know. But, you know, that's the thing, is that we don't think about that. But I remember I was out in the park one day, and I had this friend of mine with me, and from work, and I went up to somebody in the park, and I started telling them about the Messiah. And afterwards, he said to me, the guy that I was with, he said, "Please never do that to me again." And I said, "Well, aren't you a Christian?" He says, "Yes, I'm a Christian," but he says, that just bothered me so bad, you know. He said, "I was so nervous." That night, he went to run in the park. And he was sitting there and he was putting his shoes on, and this young man was running around, hallelujah, in that park. And the young man stopped, and the Lord spoke to my friend and said, "Share me with him." Next day he came to work and he said, "Roger, I will never say that to you again." He said, "Such a thing, sharing about our Lord and Savior with somebody who's never heard." It was hard for him, but he did it anyway. Pray for peace, Jerusalem, city of our God. Their salvation was put out for you. The atoning of the Lord. For once your streets were filled with joy. Branches raised up high, shouting, "Blessed be the Holy One, Yeshua Adonai." Shalom, shalom, Jerusalem. Peace be to you. When Messiah comes to take us home, may his grace be found in you. Israel, beloved, Abraham, my son, how my heart would thrill to hear you say, "Our Messiah has come." Oh, my brothers, hear his words. May they pierce your soul. Turn again to worship Adonai. Mashiach, you are. Shalom, shalom, Jerusalem. Peace be to you. When Messiah comes to take us home, may his grace be found in you. May his praise be found in you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Fill our mouths with good things, Lord, so that our youth is renewed like the eagles. Amen.
Praise ears are waiting you, O God in Zion, and to you the vow will be performed. You hear prayer, to you our flesh will come.
You will provide an atonement for them. Fields are covered with flocks. Valleys are mantled with grain, lifting their voices together. They shout with joy and they sing. Praise is awaiting you, O God in Zion. And to you the vow will be performed. You will hear prayer, to you all flesh will come. You will provide an atonement for them. You established the mountains. You created them by your might. Being clothed with your power, you made morning and evening rejoice. Praise is awaiting you, O God in Zion. And to you the vow will be performed. You hear prayer, to you all flesh will come. You will provide an atonement for them. You will provide an atonement for them.
Hallelujah. Well, whose blood was poured out for the forgiveness of your sins?
Yeshua.
Yeshua's wonderful, precious blood, which has never lost any of its power. Amen. How many of you are thankful today?
Hallelujah.
That his blood has been applied to the doorpost of your house.
Hallelujah.
Adonai, Adonai, Adonenu, Madir Simcha Mekol Haaretz. Adonai, Adonai, Adonenu, Ashet naotcha o hashamayim. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you ordained. What is man that you are mindful of him? And the Son of Man that you visit him? O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. O Lord, how excellent is your name. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. O Lord, how excellent is your name. And the Avenger you still with the praises of singers, the infants and babes who you ordain. What is man that you are mindful of him? And the Son of Man that you visit him? O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. O Lord,
praise your name, O Lord, our Lord. How excellent is your name in all the earth. O Lord, how excellent is your name. Your name, given so freely for us to claim. The name Yeshua. You came a little lower than the angels to humble yourself. Only to be exalted, exalted. Oh Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, how excellent is your name. Oh Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, how excellent is your name. How excellent is your
Today's Torah reading is from the book of Vayikra, the book of Leviticus, chapter 19, verses 1 through 8. Ya'amod Yochanan ben Martin, La Torah.
Barku et Adonai Hamvorak, Baruch Adonai Hamvorak Leolam Vaed. Baruch Ata Adonai
Eloheinu Melech Haolam
Asher Bakar Banu Mikol Hamim Venatan Lanu Et Torato Baruch Ata Adonai Notein HaTorah. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who chose us from all peoples and gave us your Torah. Blessed are you who gives us the Torah. Amen.
Amen. 1-8.
Hashem spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the entire assembly of the children of Israel and say to them, you shall be holy, for holy am I, Hashem, your God.
Yes. Amen.
Every man, your mother and father, shall you revere, and my Sabbaths shall you observe. I am Hashem, your God. Do not turn to the idols and molten gods, shall you not make for yourselves. I am Hashem, your God. When you slaughter a feast peace offering to Hashem, you shall slaughter it to find favor for yourselves. On the day of your slaughter shall it be eaten, and on the next day, and whatever remains until the third day shall be burned in fire. But if it shall be eaten on the third day, it is rejected. It shall not be accepted. Each of those who eat it will bear his iniquity, for what is sacred to Hashem has he desecrated, and that soul will be cut off from its people. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Natan Lanu Torat Emet Vekaye Olam Nata Betukenu Baruch Ata Adonai Notein HaTorah. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe. You gave us your true instruction and planted everlasting life in our midst. Blessed are you, who gives us the Torah. Amen.
God bless you.
Thank you. Good job.
He who blessed our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, may he bless Yochanan ben Martin, who has come up to honor God and the Torah. May the Holy One bless him and his family. and send blessing and prosperity on all the work of his hands. Amen. We're going to go to page 16, like we always do.
Et Chaim hi l'malchus hikimo v'tom e'ha me'ushar d'ra'e'ha d'arke
Wisdom is a tree of life to those who hold fast to her, and all who uphold her are blessed. Her ways are pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. Cause us to return to you, O Lord, and we shall return. Renew our days as of old. Today's reading from the Haftor is from the book of the prophet Yechezkel, Ezekiel, chapter 20, verses 18 through 20.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who chose good prophets, delighting in their words which were spoken truthfully. Blessed are you, O Lord, who chose the Torah, your servant Moses, your people Israel, and the prophets of truth and righteousness. I said to their children in the wilderness, do not follow the practices of your fathers, and do not observe their laws, and do not defile yourselves with their idols. I am Hashem your God. Follow my decrees and observe my laws and fulfill them. Sanctify my Sabbaths, and they shall be a sign between me and you for you to know that I am Hashem your God. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of the universe, Rock of ages, righteous in all generations, the faithful God who speaks and performs, who declares and establishes, whose words are entirely truth and righteousness.
Amen. And Nancy has a praise report she'd like to.
I do. And it fits right in here with he who speaks and performs. First of all, I want to thank all of you who've been praying for our son, Josh. As you know, he's on dialysis. Yeah. And he finished his evaluations to see if he would qualify to be on the transplant list a week or so ago. His girlfriend got tested to see if she would be a match. And right now we know that she's got the same blood type and she matches 4 out of the 6 antigens that they test for. He needs to get some dental work done so that it doesn't lead to any infections. But it looks like maybe by this summer he'll either be on the transplant list or have a match already. So we give God glory for that.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God bless you.
Thank you.
Awesome. Awesome news. In the past, God spoke to our fathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But now in the end of days, he has spoken to us by the Messiah, his son, whom he appointed the heir of all things and through whom he made the universe. The Son is the full radiance of God's glory and the flawless manifestation of his reality. He sustains all things by his powerful word. After he made atonement for sins, he sat down in the place of authority beside the majesty in heaven. And today's reading from the Berit Chadasha, the Renewed Covenant, is from the book of Kepha Rishon, 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 through 16.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God,
King of the universe, who has given us Messiah Yeshua and the words of the renewed covenant, blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the renewed covenant.
Amen. 13.
Therefore, get your minds ready for work. Keep yourselves under control and fix your hopes fully on the gift you will receive when Yeshua the Messiah is revealed. As people who obey God, do not let yourselves be shaped by the evil desires you used to have when you were still ignorant. On the contrary, following the Holy One who called you, become holy yourselves in your entire way of life, since the Tanakh says you are to be holy because I am holy.
Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the word of truth and planted among us life eternal. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the renewed covenant.
Amen. Amen. And you have a praise report also. We're just full of it today.
Yes, I do. I've been bringing my son and his family to the Seder for the last 3 years, and it seemed like it was a nice night out, but didn't really know if anything was happening. Last Sunday, my son stopped by, and we were having a nice conversation, and in the midst of the flow of the conversation, he says, "Oh, by the way, Mom, I stopped eating pork." Because this has been kind of a big deal between us. And I said, "Oh, interesting. Why is that?" He says, "Well, at the Seder, you know, Rabbi said something about Jesus observing Hanukkah. And I've read the New Testament. I don't remember seeing that in there, but I looked it up." And he went, "It's in there." And it got me thinking. And, you know, over the course of time, we've had conversations about the biblical feasts and the God-approved feasts and those kinds of things. And so I was very blessed when he told me this. And I said, "Well, what does your wife have to say about that?" He said, "Well, I didn't really talk to her about it. But, you know, after a short time, you know, she stopped eating pork too." And I said, "Oh, and again, why did you stop eating pork?" He says, "Well, I began to realize God is eternal, and so his word is eternal, and it doesn't change." And so...
Awesome. What a blessing. What a blessing.
Hallelujah.
You know, we labor for all these years, and we never hear anything. You know, I've never saved anybody. I've never seen anybody come to salvation. I've never heard of anything, you know, and then all of a sudden, out of the sky comes that email. Wow, I was blown away this week. You made my week, you know. But now I'd like to bless all the women that are here today, see if that has an effect. And if you're not married, we're going to bless you anyway, because Isaiah 62:5 says, "As a bridegroom rejoices over his bride, so will your God rejoice over you." So this blessing is for all the women that are here today. And if you're close to the one you love, put your arm around her.
Ishet Khalil Mimsa, 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 Verakot Mipninim, Verakot Mipninim, Verakot Mipninim, Mikra, Batak, Vale. Bishalal, 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 Lo Yechadal.
A woman of valor, who can find? She is worth far more than precious jewels. The heart of her husband safely trusts in her, and he profits greatly thereby. Bless you all. And we honor you here. Oh, this is going to work out.
Amen.
We need some children to come down. Children of the world, physical ones first. Yeah, I know there's a few in there. Not you, not yet. Yeah, you will come down. But you have to come in order. And first we want the physical children of God. Come on, children. Come on down. You're next. There we go. Now we'll take all those digital and cardboard people that you carry around with you. And then we'll take people like Mark who need to come down because they act like children half the time. Park, Mark. Hey, Mark, get over here and park. Yisimcha Elohim ki Yeshua HaMashiach. May God make you as Yeshua, our Messiah. May the Spirit of the Lord rest upon you, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of power, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. And may you delight in the fear of the Lord. Bless you, children. Go in peace. Amen. Shabbat Shalom. And Shabbat school is now open. He's happy to go. Can tell. He wants to go to Shabbat school.
Right.
Doubt it.
Happy is the child. About the word of God.
Oh, Lord.
Gravity still works.
Melech ozev Mashiach Magan. Melech ozev Mashiach Magan. Baruch atah Adonai, Baruch atah Adonai, Magen Avraham. Baruch atah Adonai, Baruch atah Adonai, Magen Abraham, King, Redeemer, Savior and Shield. King, Redeemer, Savior and Shield. Blessed art thou, blessed art thou, Shield of Abraham. Blessed art thou, blessed art thou, Shield of Abraham. Melech ozev Mashiach umagan. Melech ozev Mashiach umagan.
Baruch Ata Adonai, Baruch Ata Adonai, Magen Abraham. Baruch Ata Adonai, Baruch Ata Adonai, Magen Abraham. King, Redeemer, Savior and Shield. King, Redeemer, Savior and Shield. Blessed art thou, blessed art thou, Shield of Abraham. Blessed art thou, blessed art thou, Shield of Abraham. Melech Ozer Mashiach Umagan. Melech Ozer Mashiach Umagan. Baruch Ata Adonai, Baruch Ata Adonai, Magen Abraham. Baruch Ata Adonai, Baruch Ata Adonai, Magen Abraham.
Me. Keep dropping my... Look what I found. Look what I found. Huh? No, it doesn't work. You better get me a new one. Can't speak anymore. My lips are sealed. But not long enough to tell you that next Sunday is lunch day at Open Door Mission. A lot of you said, what is ODM when I put it in the bulletin? So that means Open Door Mission. So I put it in there today. I wrote it out and put it in parentheses, ODM, Open Door Mission. It's just code for Open Door Mission. And, you know, I'm sorry if I messed you up and you didn't show up last month. But we would like you to show up next week. Even though it's Mother's Day, there are mothers there. And I know that because my wife is going to be there, and she has three children, which I also have. But it's Mother's Day, not Father's Day, so yeah. I always get stuck at the ballgame. All right, and we're also, I'm working on the Israel trip. I've got the itinerary just about done with the travel agent. I've been working with him, and we're tweaking the final parts of it, so I'll be able to get out an itinerary to you soon. And it's going to be an awesome trip, better than any of the trips we've had before. So if you want to go to Israel, this will be the time to do it. Okay, today is the 28th day of the Omer. If you've been counting it every day, you know that. And if you don't, well, I'm reminding you from 7 days ago. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kidishanu b'mitzvotav, v'tzivanu al sefirat ha-omer. So today is day 28. So we go there and go, Hayom shmona v'esrim yom shehem arba'ah shavuot ba'omer. Today is 28 days, which are 4 weeks of the Omer. And so the compassionate one, may he return for us the service of the temple to its place speedily and in our days. And everyone is going to say all at once, Amen. Wow, you're good. Guys can do that, huh? Okay, so we're going to, I started a while back, you know, trying to alternate my teachings between the books of Acts and the book of Joshua. I told you that. And we had to take a little detour because of the holy days and the feast days and all the other things that come up in between. So now I'm going to get back on track again. So we'll go back to the book of Joshua. We're going to do chapter 2. Who can be used? Yeah, that's what we want to talk about today. And so I think we're going to read out the book first, right? I said I would read it and then I would... preach about it, right? If you want to hear some really good preaching, about another God. Go down to the CenturyLink Center. There's 44,000 people down there learning about the God of this world from their guru and master priest, Pope of the Berkshire Hathaway Corporation. Or you could stay here and listen to God. All right, we'll stay here then. Then Joshua, son of Nun, secretly sent out two spies from Shittim saying, go explore the land, especially Jericho. So they went and came to the house of a prostitute whose name was Rahab and lodged there. The king of Jericho was told some men from Bnei Yisrael have just come here tonight to spy out the land. So the king of Jericho sent word to Rahab saying, bring out the men who came to you, who entered your house, for they have come to spy out all the land. But the woman took the two men and hid them and said, yes, the men did come to me, but I didn't know where they were from. So when it was time to shut the gate at dark, the men went out, and I don't know where they went. Pursue them quickly, for you may overtake them. But she had brought them up to the roof and hid them in the stalks of flax that she had spread out on the roof. So the men pursued them on the road to the fords of the Jordan. As soon as the pursuers had gone out, they shut the gate. Now before they lay down, she came up to them on the roof, and she said to the men, I know that Adonai has given you the land. Dread of you has fallen on us, and all the inhabitants of the land are melting in fear before you. For we have heard how Adonai dried up the waters of the Sea of Reeds before you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites that were beyond the Jordan, to Sihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. When we heard about it, our hearts melted, and no spirit remained anymore in anyone because of you. For Adonai, your God, he is God in heaven above and on the earth beneath. So now please swear to me by Adonai, since I have dwelt kindly with you, that you will also deal kindly with my father's house. Give me a true sign that you will spare the lives of my family, my mother, my brothers, my sisters, and all who belong to them, and save our lives from death. The men said to her, our life for yours, if you don't report this business of ours. Then it will be when Adonai gives us the land that we will deal kindly and loyally with you. So she lowered them down by a rope through the window, for her house was in the wall. She was living in the wall. Then she said to them, go to the hill country, lest the pursuers meet you, and hide yourselves there for 3 days until the pursuers return. Afterward, you may go your way. Then the men said to her, we will be released from this oath that you have made us swear, unless when we come into the land, you tie this line of scarlet thread in your window to which you lowered us down and gather to yourself in the house your father, your mother, your brothers, and all your father's household. Whoever goes out the doors of your house into the street, his blood will be on his head and we will be innocent. But whoever is with you in the house, his blood will be on our head if any hand is laid on him. But if you divulge this business of ours, then we will be released from your oath you have made us swear. So she said, according to your words, so be it. Then she sent them away. After they had gone, she tied the scarlet cord to the window. Then they departed and came to the hill country. They stayed there for 3 days until the pursuers returned. Now the pursuers had looked for them all along the road, but had not found them. Then the two men returned, came down from the hill country, crossed over, and came to Joshua, son of Nun. They reported to him all that had befallen them. Surely Adonai has given all the land into our hands, they said to Joshua. Indeed, all the inhabitants of the land have melted in fear before us. Amen. How about that? So here, Israel was camped at Shittim, several miles across the Jordan River from the town of Jericho. Joshua had received his leadership credentials from God to become Moses' successor and taken his position as commander-in-chief. His leadership is consolidated as this huge migrating nation has put behind it 40 years of murmuring, squabbling. They are ready to claim God's promise of the promised land. Tucked into the history of the conquest is the fascinating story of two spies and a prostitute named Rahab. Joshua, needing some final military intelligence about Jericho, sent two young men disguised as foreign travelers to the ancient fortress stronghold, so critical to the Israelite entrance into the land. It was not surprising that these two spies found refuge in the house of a harlot who was most likely an innkeeper. Authorities were used to seeing strange characters go and come from a strange place like that, a place as good as any to maintain some kind of anonymity. They might have been able to gather intelligence of a military nature there, even though it may not have been the best place for a person of God to be. It would not be good for godly people to frequent such kind of places. The king of Jericho, most likely a typical Canaanite king, had his operatives at work, and the presence of the spies was reported to him. Suspecting that the two men were spies, come to search out the land, his officers demanded that Rahab produce them. But she had already hidden them under stalks of flax on the roof. Pointing toward the Jordan River, she told the authorities that the men had left the city under the cover of night. Why did she lie to them? Most likely she had overheard conversations that had taken place in her house. The soldiers and the citizens of Jericho couldn't help but be alarmed by that huge migrating nation that was camped on the other side of the river. As soon as the pursuers went out looking for the two spies, the gate to Jericho got shut down and locked up. Fascinated by the two Israelites, Rahab went up to the roof and expressed her own fear of the future and the fear that was beginning to grip all of the inhabitants of that land. She acknowledged her conviction that the God of Israel was determined to give the land over to the Hebrew people. Rumors had come about how the Red Sea had dried up before they came out some 40 years ago when they left Egypt. Rahab was also aware of their victories over the Amorite kings, Sihon and Og, who had been utterly destroyed in Deuteronomy and Numbers, it's written. And in chapter 2, verse 11, as soon as she heard these things, our hearts melted, neither did there remain any more courage in anyone because of you, for the Lord your God, he is God in the heavens above and on the earth beneath. Not only was Rahab gripped by fear, but also deep within her there was a feminine, intuitive sense that there were larger forces here at work. It's amazing to find the sensitivities and insight of some people who make no profession of faith in Yeshua at all. In the most confused and evil people, there can be a spark of spiritual sensitivity that, when fanned by the breath of the Holy Spirit, can burst into hot flames. Isn't that cool? But I also find myself sadly disillusioned by the lack of wisdom and perception of some who profess a faith in Yeshua but have chosen to block themselves off from reflective observation. In a self-protective plea, Rahab begged the men to offer a promise of safety for her and her family as repayment for having hidden them. In verses 12 and 13, "Now therefore I beg you to swear to me that since I've shown you kindness, you'll also be kind to my house," right? And the spies agreed to that. The location of her house made it easy for her to help them. Some scholars surmise that Jericho was surrounded by two walls with a space of 12 to 15 feet between them, and the inner wall being the strongest. Houses were built over the gap between the two walls, supported by timbers laid from one wall to the other, and supported by small cross walls of bricks. Because of this, her window probably faced out over the outer wall. She lowered the men by rope through the window, pointed them towards the hills, urged them to hide in the hills, head for them hills there, for 3 days until the pursuers returned, and then cross over the Jordan back towards Shittim. The spies promised to respect her request to protect her family if she promised to keep their secret and don't tell anyone about their visit. They pointed to a scarlet rope and told her to hang it in the window. Any of her family who remained in the house during that conquest would be safe. However, they warned if anyone told anyone about the business, they would not be bound any longer by this promise, right? So they departed, doing precisely what she said, finally returning to the camp and giving assurance to Joshua in verse 24. Truly the Lord has delivered all the land into our hands, for indeed all the inhabitants are faint-hearted because of us. After Jericho was captured, the first item on the agenda of the two young spies was to rescue Rahab and her entire family prior to destroying the city by fire. That's in chapter 6, verses 22 through 25. What a super story that is. Most of us are quite familiar with it. However, the people with whom we communicate generally might not know about this story, have a ready memory of it. The name Rahab probably triggers some popular stereotype reactions from people you might be talking to when you tell them about it, but they usually eclipse the historical narrative. So, God uses not only his own prophets and leaders to bring faith and courage to Israel, God uses the most unexpected and immoral people to further his purposes in the world. I don't know if you know that, but he does. The leadership of Joshua depended upon Moses is one side of the picture. The power of God to convince even the enemy is the other side. People of God must be open to learn from all sources which God would use. Okay, we must always be aware of our own prejudiced tendencies to look to powerful leaders for direction and to fear powerful enemy leaders. Throughout the Bible and all of church history, God has opened new doors and new opportunities for his people through the most unlikely of all people. Through it all, God has shown himself able to fulfill the promises he has made. He has indeed proved to be the God of heaven above and the earth below. So, a first major observation in all this is God has a way of working through very ordinary and unlikely people when he does things. I take tremendous encouragement from this fact. God never depends on Time, Newsweek, U.S. News and World Reports, or ABC or Fox News and their analysis of the most influential men and women in America. He doesn't care about those sources. In the English-speaking Western society or even in the world, we're privileged to underline the fact that it is seldom that God makes his primary movement through those people whom you and I would be inclined to call great movers and shakers of this world. It's a fascinating paradox. On the one hand, God is the sovereign creator and sustainer of all that there is. On the other hand, he is limited. He is sovereign, but at the same time, he has to at least to some degree limit his power by giving free will to all human beings. Some of the most gifted, talented, and prominent people use their resources selfishly for themselves, right? And actually become debilitated by their gifts. Then God has to look elsewhere for help and ends up using people of more modest talents and even questionable reputations. That's pretty reassuring for me because it kind of talks about me. The truth can be illustrated in the events following Moses' sending out of the 12 spies. 10 had came back with a negative report, right? 2 came back with a positive report. But they weren't given the time of day by the Israelites that were there. The people scoffed at their optimism, thus minimizing God's capacity. 40 years later, the 10 prominent spies who had carried that majority, they were all dead. The only 2 that were left were Joshua and Caleb, the 2 that gave the positive report. God had honored the faithfulness of those who had refused to decide with the majority and blessing their lives and ministries. Now, 40 years later, Joshua sends only 2 men to spy out Jericho. These were 2 young men. And guess what? You don't know their names, do you? Because they're anonymous. Our people needed to be constantly reminded that God works this way through ordinary people of no special renown. The way he is, man. God works through very ordinary and unlikely people, such as the spies. And then there's Rahab, who has four strikes against her. Number one, strike one, she's a Canaanite, not a Jew. She's not even Jewish, this girl. Because of her bold act of befriending the spies, she and her extended family now become part of Israel because of what she did. She, all the Canaanites were not to be labeled wicked. Rahab group is a reminder of the fact that there were large bodies of potential allies in that decadent and corrupt city-state society. The wickedness lay in the system in which some oppressed others. Many, however, could find freedom by crossing over to join the kingdom movement. Strike two. Some of you aren't going to like this, but Rahab was a woman. There is a Jewish prayer that Orthodox Jewish men do every morning. I'm telling you, it's in my prayer book, but I don't pray it, but they do. And they thank God every morning that they were not born a woman. I swear to you, Orthodox Jews have that in their siddur. This attitude has been demonstrated in patriarchal societies in various ways throughout the centuries. Women have been forced to become militant in Western society in order to get equal rights, right? Many do not yet have the opportunity that should be theirs for personal advancement, much less do they receive equal pay for equal works. Probably not in a lot of places. In many parts of the world, they still live as second-class citizens without the right to vote, and in some cultures are even considered as objects to be owned. Sorry, that's the truth. There are still cultures where female babies are subject to infanticide. They kill them. God worked through this most fascinating person named Rahab, a woman. Wow. God celebrates femaleness just as much as he does maleness. Because he said in Genesis that both were created equal. All right. Now I acknowledge God's affirmation of both female and male alike in his original creation. I think Adam had both those traits, and then one of them was taken away from him to create the other. And they became an incomplete person then. That's the way I look at it. Strike three. Not only was those Canaanite and a woman, she was a prostitute. She didn't work as a secretary at Mutual. Let's assume it doesn't bother us that God was working through a Canaanite. I mean, you know, he worked through Cyrus, right? A Persian. Not everyone could be an Israelite. I mean, you know, they were the chosen people, but there are only a few of them. Let's even imagine that in our chauvinistic culture of that time or today, God could even work through a woman. No, we could accept that, maybe. 50% of us are women, or so. But the idea of God working through a prostitute? Come on. That may present problems for some of us. We need to stress that God sees potential in every single one of us. He wants all to be saved. And he wants to make the most of that potential that you have in you. As much as some will resist this truth, others struggling with guilt and broken dreams will find enormous relief and renewed hope as we develop this reassuring principle. God loves you and wants you to be the best you can be, no matter who you are. Some of the writers tried to portray Rahab as a cultic prostitute tied into the Canaanite fertility goddess worship. This seems unlikely as there was another Hebrew word to describe a religious prostitute. Most likely, Rahab and her family came from the poor segment of Jericho society. The flax on the roof of the house gives the impression that her family lived by agriculture outside of the city. The flax bundles were probably hauled up on the roof through the window, perhaps by the same rope that the spies were let down on. Her family might have worked the land for some noble who supplied the flax for the linen workers, such as those mentioned in 1 Chronicles 4:21, who would in turn produce linen for the garments of the priests and the upper-class people of Jericho. Rahab's house on the wall would serve as a place for her family to stay when they were in the city. Rahab had probably, out of economic necessity, earned a living as a prostitute. Like most prostitutes, she lived right on the edge of society. In ancient cities as today, Rahab's occupational group is tolerated, but they went entirely without recognition unless it was in the highly honored self-lived prominence of cultic religious prostitution. God has a way of working through the most ordinary and unlikely people who live very much on the edge of social respectability. You know who attracted those people? Yeshua, to his inner circle. Okay, you got all those, right? Strike four. More than a baseball game. She was dishonest. Some people excuse lying in some situations, and I struggle with that. There are occasions when dishonesty is the highest ethic, such as a time of war when one's own loved ones are threatened with illegal arrest and punishment. Are you going to lie for them to protect them? Yeah. At what point is a situational ethic part of the biblical witness? I read passages in which I'm instructed to let my yea be yea and my nay be nay. If I had to lean any one direction, it would be toward a strict interpretation of the biblical admonitions toward honesty. I believe that God calls us all to be people of integrity. Yet, here we have a strange combination. Rahab is a harlot and a liar who at the same time is a person of faith. How about that? Perhaps this is because the light that often comes gradually and slowly to people like Rahab and frankly, like a lot of us, maybe, the conscience is slowly enlightened. How many people were slaveholders before they became Christians? John Newton continued for some time in the slave trade, exporting his cargoes of fellow human beings, stolen from their homes before he awoke to sense his sin and his crime. It took a while to get there. No wonder he later wrote the words Amazing Grace. How sweet that sound, right? He wrote that song. That saved a wretch like me, because once I was lost, but now I am found, was blind, but now I see. Amen. I have no question that Rahab had changed both her profession and her ethics as she threw in her lot with God's people. But there can be no doubt as to how she was living when she first came into contact with the Israelites. Before I got saved, I was a drunk laying in the streets, so what's the big deal? Doesn't bother me. Look at me now. Rahab was on the outermost circle of faith, just touching the boundaries. But the nearer she would come to the Lord, the more she would recoil from her previous lifestyle. Nonetheless, God is able to use the most unlikely of us. And in the process, you know what he does? He transforms us. Yeah. She was a most unusual mother. She came through quite a pilgrimage. She married. She settled down. She raised a family and actually became one of Yeshua's ancestors on Joseph's side. She's in the genealogy. All you got to do, we need to emphasize the fact that she's listed in Matthew. You have Matthew there? 1:5-6. Yeah. She's... Salmon begat Boaz by Rahab. Boaz begat Obed by Ruth. Obed begat Jesse. And Jesse begat David, the king. Rahab was a most unusual woman. Not only is she included in the lineage of Yeshua, but she is also lauded as an example of living faith in Hebrews 11:31 and is affirmed for her good works in James 2:25. Wow. What outstanding evidence of God's capacity to work through very ordinary and unlikely people. In Matthew, let me read something to you from this guy, E. John Hamlin. Rahab was a paradigm of hope, showing that the old idols, the old corrupt ways of the past could be given up. What Rahab did just before the fall of Jericho, Israel could do before or after the fall of Jerusalem. The contrast between Rahab at the bottom of the social order and the king and nobles of Jericho at the top illustrates what Yeshua said in Matthew 21:31. Harlots go into the kingdom of God before you. Not only does this chapter of Joshua emphasize our first major observations that God works through very ordinary and very unlikely people, it also brings us to a second observation. Rahab is worth having as a model. You want to be like her. Not like she was, but like she is. There are five particular qualities in her life that can be instructive to you. First, Rahab had street smart openness to truth from wherever it came. She was faithful to what little light she did have. I think I have street smarts. I grew up on the streets, and you know, I learned that there's a more of a better way to learn things than intellectually. And so I kind of developed that myself. She was faithful to what little light she had. Those who don't learn from her because have an inclination to live with a closed mind. I like to have everything neat. Some people like to have everything neatly packaged. They don't want their security shaken. Their desire for order and symmetry can cause them to live their life boxed in. And boxes are limiting. You've got to think outside the boxes and do things that are unconventional for your position. Rahab and her fellow citizens of Jericho have heard about the Jews, whom we see as the underdogs. This isn't necessarily always true. It is true that the citizens of Jericho could have been alarmed by the huge encampment across the river. I'm sure that scared the heck out of them. Rumors have a way of getting to the enemy side also. Rumors, ooh. Rahab also had heard about the Red Sea drying up and how the Israelites defeated those two kings. But she was unwilling to be paralyzed by fear. In her own embryonic way, she was prepared to think theologically. Who are these people? Their God did all that. He must be a powerful guy. Rahab's questions were a great starting point for her faith. She was open to truth. We need to expand our own parameters of thought. And part of our prophetic ministry that we have is to challenge people to a lifestyle of growth. As threatening as that lifestyle can be, you've got to take a step outside of your boundaries, folks. A lot of times, if you want to make it to the next place. We need to challenge ourselves and those with whom we talk to be willing to be surprised by God. Perhaps it was because she was a prostitute that Rahab was looking for something better. You know, Rahab might simply have been an open person who saw a need for change in her life. Perhaps things were not as functional the way they were. Perhaps she was a very religious person seeking true spiritual reality or a cause more worthy than she had experienced before. She could have been just fascinated by those two young men, Hebrew foreigners, who weren't interested in using her body. She never met a man like these before, probably. Their God must not only be a God of great power, victorious in battle, he might also be a God who could bring to her a new beginning, a new ethic, a new self-esteem. Aren't you sometimes looking for a new thing to start over with? It's exciting to talk to an open-minded person. I like it when people come up to ask me about what my ministry is like, you know, or what's doing. And these are people I meet on the street or people I meet in the gym or people I meet everywhere. I sit in the hot tub at the gym and talk to people about Adat and God. One guy gave me a book to read. Said, it's a book I wrote about David. I'm going to read it, but he wants me to critique it for him. I like it because and it's a lot of these people are Christians, and so I tell them about the Jewish roots of their faith. I would love to have invitations to different places to go and speak. You know, I used to speak in churches all the time, but I haven't gotten any lately. We are reassured in Scripture that if with all of our heart we seek the Lord, we will find him. Seek and you shall find, knock and it will be opened. I think Yeshua said that somewhere. Second, Rahab is a place you go. Rahab, I probably need to go there, had the courage to make a tough decision. She didn't have a lot of time to think things through. She heard about the Jews. And now there's two of them in her house. Man, what are you going to do with all these Jews in your house? She was available immediately to the job of hiding them. If you find a Jew in your house, you better hide him. Our availability to God can change the whole future of our lives and perhaps the lives of others. Are we going to be available to Him? Are we willing to take action? Are we willing to pledge ourselves to Him without all the answers? I know people who are immobilized for a lifetime by indecision. They are masters of the do-nothing decision. They muse and philosophize forever. Once we have settled some of the basic decisions, we have God's prophetic mandate to challenge those to whom we preach, to teach, to make a clear-cut decision for Yeshua. We are to point out the fallacy that the Apostle Paul referred to in 2 Timothy 3:7. Always learning and never coming to the knowledge of the truth. Third, Rehab was willing to join a new family, the family of God. She probably didn't fully understand the significance of the scarlet rope that she was told to hang out of her window. They came to understand in the years ahead the significance of the blood sacrifice and the ordinance of the Passover. Perhaps the scarlet cord had in its color a significance that reached forward in history to the blood atonement of Yeshua HaMashiach. It might have been simply her way of tying a yellow ribbon around the old oak tree, signifying her identity, her love and trust for a new people and God she was only beginning to know. For Rahab, the scarlet rope was sacramental. It was an outward sign of an inner work of grace, which God was bringing to pass in her life. It was a sign that she believed God to be God. She wasn't going to add one more God to her list of gods she had with the Canaanites. Rahab was willing to put aside all those gods for just the one true God. Hallelujah. Whom she would grow to know much more intimately in the future. Wow. God would enable her to get a new life together in such a way that she and her loved ones would become an integral part of the Jewish family. I love and like all of you because you did the same thing by coming here. I mean, wow. You had to get a new family because the old family wasn't working for you. And look what you've done. You have swam up the current, man. You ever try swimming upstream? That's what we're doing. I like you guys for doing that. Her name would go down in history not only as a harlot, but also as a prostitute saved by grace of God. And one of the world's most unusual mothers. Speaking of Mother's Day, the mother of Boaz, which made her the great-great-grandmother of King David. One of the direct ancestors of Joseph, the husband of Mary, to whom Yeshua was born. Fourth, she had a loyalty to her own human family. What a virtue. She was willing to persuade them to trust her and her newfound God. She had to bring others into it. She assumed the responsibility not just for herself, but for her loved ones. She took care of her family. Rahab ran the risk of exposing herself as a traitor, as an enemy within the gates of her own native city by leading on that. Our loved ones need to know what we believe. You need to tell your family what you believe. Sometimes it's really difficult, I know. Believe me, I have the same problem, deeper than you maybe. They deserve the right to see the seriousness of our love for Yeshua. They all do. And to know that this love makes us all the more loyal to them as family. What an alternative is Christian motherhood to the secular approach, huh? Remember Shirley MacLaine was an actress? She was a very gifted woman. She was brilliant, but she was confused. In a Time magazine interview, she characterized her daughter Sashi's birth as an accident. She said she never considered having another child. She added, I never really embraced the label motherhood. I chose to call it personhood. Sashi and I are very close persons to each other. I let her grow up. She knows that anything she does is okay with me. What we see in the confused family loyalties of the secular entertainment world is also reflected at the other end of the economic spectrum in the communities that we have here. There is deep concern about the breakdown of the American family. I mean, 96% of American families are dysfunctional. It's a crisis. Single-parent households are at the highest, right? Same-sex marriages now, et cetera, et cetera. Those who do not relate either to the upper strata of the entertainment world or the lowest level are those. The absent white upper middle class parent is so intent on, even those who are happily married, you think, people, maybe some of you, but you're so intent on professional advancement, economic gain, career recognition, that your home is emptied both of father and mother. Even if you're together, you have that problem. This means the home is without any viable substitute for intimacy, for nurture, for worship, ultimate concern, conveying a sense of the solidarity of the family and the specialness and importance that the family unit of each individual. Nobody's home. Rahab loved her family. The scarlet cord was not appropriated just for herself, but for all those who were willing to join her in her faith. Number five, finally, Rahab had a lasting faith in the Lord. Perseverance. She had met the conditions of faith and was willing to follow through. Now she had to conform her ways to God's ways, not just in the initial salvation of her life, but in her whole new identity. No longer a prostitute, no longer a Canaanite. Rahab was now a proselyte, one who became part of the Hebrew community, a believer in the Lord. There was a new moral, spiritual, and social framework within her for living. She fleshed out what it is for a person to become a new creation in Yeshua. What a privilege, rather, to study the story of Rahab, one who became the ultimate example of what the Apostle Paul described as happening time after time in the book of Corinthians he wrote in chapter 6, 1 Corinthians 9 through 11. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkenness, nor revelers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, including me, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Yeshua and by the Spirit of God. What a privilege it is to convey in our daily lives that God is in the business of working through very ordinary and unlikely people like us, producing in each of us qualities of his new creation, starting with us right where we are. So I'm going to leave you with this. Be open to all things and be open to all people. Don't run away because somebody is begging you and carrying a brown paper bag around. That was me. You can't witness if you just hang out together with each other. You got to expand your horizons. Boldly go where no man has gone before. Seek out and explore. What is that they say? Star Trek. Bible studies, prayer circles, church groups. They're all good. I'm not knocking them. Believe me. But you just isolate yourselves, if that's all you do, from those who really need to hear the word. If all you do is go from this Bible study to that prayer group to that church function, who are you witnessing to? What is your purpose for getting saved? It's not so you can have a good time reading the word. It's for witnessing to other people and telling them what God wants you to say. That's why you got saved. You didn't get saved to sit in a little group and isolate yourself. Pray for boldness in your life to speak out, to go to places where you wouldn't. I go to bars. I'm 26 years sober, but I could sit in a bar and not have a drink. I understand how it is. I know what that'll do to me. Look what happened here. A prostitute helped Israel achieve what it couldn't do on its own. A lowly prostitute. Don't ever write off a person. Don't ever judge a book by its cover. Never. Amen. I'm done. That's enough for today. You heard it. So let's go to the Kaddish, I guess. Page 26. Man. And we'd like to remember those we've lost in the past year. We'd like to remember, and tomorrow is the yard site for Lee Walker, Salome Ken, Marcy Cheney, Ruth Johnson, Frank Armbrust, Sandra Stock, Betty Learn, Doug Sweats, Daniel Washburn, Johanna Chernoff, Elizabeth Hunt, Clark Olmsted, Denny Breckbill, Jean Phillip, Gladys Valentine, Vern Welch, Mavis Hobart, Robert Woodward, Patty Seif, Rachel Rosenberg, Alex M., Eric N., and Josephine N. I'd like to remember all those babies that never had a chance to live and all those killed in military or terrorist action. I'd also like to remember all those people that died in Nepal. It was a horrible, horrible earthquake. I do have friends here who from Nepal, and their families are okay, so I was very excited to hear that. But there are a lot of dead people in Nepal right now. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Tony's yard site, okay. Tony Sikora. Anybody else? Steve Weber. Okay. Anybody else? Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Yikadal v'yikadash, shmei rabah, v'yalma, divra, chirutei, v'yamlech, malchutei, v'chayichon, v'yamechon, v'chayedichal, beit Yisrael, v'agala, v'izman, kari, v'mru, amen. Yehei shmei rabah, mavorach, le'olam, olamei, amaya. Yit barak, v'yishtabach, v'yit pa'ar, v'yit romam, v'yit nasei, v'yit hadar, v'yit alev, v'yit halal, shmei dekudishah, b'irachu. La min kol birchata v'shir ata tush bechata v'nechmata dami ram biyama v'mru amen yehesh shlama rabah min shemaya v'chayim aleinu v'yal kol Yisrael v'mru amen osei shalom v'mru mav hu yasei shalom aleinu v'yal kol Yisrael v'mru amen. Magnified and sanctified be His great name in the world. He has created according to His will. May He establish His kingdom during your life and during your days, during the life of the whole house of Israel, even swiftly and soon, and say,
Amen.
Let His great name be blessed forever and to all eternity. Blessed, praised, and glorified, exalted, extolled, and honored, magnified and lauded be the name of the Holy One, blessed is He. Though He be high above all the blessings and songs, praises and consolations which are uttered in the world, and say, may there be great peace from heaven and life for us and for all Israel, and say,
Amen.
May He who makes peace in His high places make peace upon us and upon all Israel, and say,
Amen.
Page 29.
Yaseh shalom, shalom aleinu, ve'okol
Jerusalem.
I know we did it last week, but I like it.
Go to page 32 for Ain Kelohene. Don't pass go. Yeah. Don't collect $200.
In Keloheinu, in Kadoneinu, in Kamalkeinu, in Kamoshieinu, mi Keloheinu, mi Kadoneinu, mi Kamalkeinu, mi Kamoshieinu. No dall'Adoneinu, no dall'Amalcheinu, no dall'Amoshieinu. Baruch Eloheinu, Baruch Adoneinu, Baruch Malcheinu, Baruch Moshieinu. Ata hu Eloheinu, ata hu Adoneinu, ata hu Malkeinu, ata hu Moshieinu, ata hu Shekiru, avoteinu, lefaneka, ekentoret.
Okay, turn to page 33, turn and face Jerusalem, the flag behind you. As deep in her heart hums a Jewish soul, and forward to the east, an eye gazes to Zion. Our hope will not be lost, the hope of 2,000 years to be a free people in our land. Amen. It's our tradition to form a prayer circle around the sanctuary for those who wish to participate. If you have prayer request cards filled out, I'll take them from you. If you want to join us for Oneg in the lobby and for the other thing, Torah study. Yeah, we'll do that later. Is that what it's called?
Yeah, that'll work.
The prayer request card? Thank you.
Yeah, and that's why
poor Emily.
Richard isn't here, because Teresa, his lovely wife, is ill.
She's ill? Okay.
He needs prayer.
Well, we pray for Teresa then.
So,
when we do prayer, why don't we do that?
Amen. Adonai,
Elohim, Devaot, Adonai, Elohim, Devaot.
Avinu Malkeinu, our Father, our King, we thank you for this day. We praise your holy name for being the great I am, for being there for all of us. We praise you for being involved in Joshua Lorimer's life. For,
yes.
We praise you for the good report that we got today for Joshua, and we praise you, and we know that you will continue to be there for Joshua, and that we pray that all good things come out of all this,
yes,
and that
Lord,
it continues. And we praise you for Brenda's son, and the decision he made, thanks to the Seder that he attended. And
yes,
we just continue to praise you for doing wonderful things like that in everybody's life. And we praise and we pray for you to be in everyone's life, Lord. We pray for boldness for all those
yes
who need it today. We pray that you would be open to helping these people witness to people that they don't know, to go into places that they're a little afraid to go to, Lord, and to be a good witness to their family, to their friends, to everybody they come in contact with, and
yeah,
let them know about Yeshua HaMashiach. Lord, we just praise you, and we thank you for allowing us to do that. We pray this week also for people, for Teresa, that she would get well.
Yes, Lord.
We lift up Richard at this time, that you would bless them both. And we pray for little Emily McGill. We don't know her. She's having surgery Thursday morning. Lori Schmaus is her friend. And
yes, Lord.
So we lift her up, Lord,
yes,
and we ask you to surround her with your angels and bless
yes
her and bring her through this surgery. Little children need to have positive surgeries.
Yes.
And Lord, we just ask for that.
Yes.
We also lift up Thea and the Parks household, Thea McDonald, as they continue to move forward through the testing and the coming chemo that's coming. We lift them all up in the
yes
that family, Lord.
Yes.
We also pray for safe travel as Fran Parks returns from New Zealand
yes
on Tuesday.
Yes.
We just ask that you bless them, watch over and protect that whole family, and bring them all to us with good reports, especially back. We lift up our brother, Mac. We also pray for Paul Shack's mother, Jean.
Yes.
She's in the hospital with exhaustion.
Yes.
Doctors don't know what the issue is. They're still doing tests, but we just lift her up to you and just ask you to resolve this situation and get her back on her feet and bring her back home to everybody. In Yeshua's holy name, we ask all of these
yes
things.
Lord.
Yevarechecha Adonai v'yishmerecha. Yareh Adonai panav elecha v'chunecha. Yisahaha Adonai panav elecha v'yasim lecha. Shalom. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace in the name of Yeshua, the Prince of Peace. B'Shem Yeshua Mashiachenu. Amen. Shabbat Shalom.